I think it's a great topic and very relevant one in the present times because like all of us keep on saying, we are in the diabetic capital. We do see a lot of diabetics, gestational and pre-gestational during pregnancy, and they are becoming a little more and more complicated. And I think many of them now need medical management with some medication or the other. And we know the pluses and minuses of insulin, and therefore the oral hypoglycemic agents are coming in a big way. So there are a lot of queries and doubts in the minds of all those who practice as to when to, can we give it at all? And if so, when and where? And therefore, as I already said, gestational diabetes complicates about 2 to 10% of pregnancies, almost 16 to 17% in India. 2 to 10 globally. It is generally diagnosed in the late second trimester because most screening recommendations are for the second trimester, but now it is, and of course gestational diabetes occurs later in pregnancy than pre-gestational. But with early screening now, we do diagnose them early. They may be pre-gestational, but the diagnosis is made pretty early and they are still called gestational. Unless a cutoff is exceeded, occurs due to inability of beta cells to cope with the increasing insulin resistance. And we know that if uncontrolled, it contributes to poor perinatal and maternal outcome. So when we go to the management of gestational diabetes, I'm not dealing with anything else. We all know that we start with the adjustments in the diet, which is now called by the fancy term, medical nutritional therapy. They are also recommended exercises. The recommendations vary about 30 minutes every day for 5 days a week or whatever. And the sugars are not controlled with these measures. Medical management is recommended. And from time immemorial, from the time we have been students, we have always said that insulin is the drug of choice, and it is still the standard of care and is the safest and time-tested. Insulin and insulin analogs are equally effective. Of course, there are pros and cons, which I will not discuss here. And tight control is possible with multiple doses and close monitoring when we use insulin. And maternal and perinatal outcome are excellent. So then why are we looking for an alternative if you have this magic medication? Obviously, because insulin comes with its minuses as well, it has to be administered in multiple doses. Injections are generally not easily accepted by anyone I know, being a diabetic for the last 20 odd years. Storage is a problem, especially in lower socioeconomic strata. Women have to be trained in self-administration, and it is very difficult. I mean, now that I work in a community hospital, I know the practical problems of educating them how to take the injection, how to even the measure the exact units, etc. And I'm sure many of you have the same experience. Monitoring of blood sugars must be very frequent and regular when insulin is used, because hypoglycemia is an issue if you don't keep a close watch. Maternal weight gain is a problem, because if you keep it under very tight control, or even if there are frequent hypoglycemic episodes, they tend to eat to overcome the symptomatic hypoglycemia. And that is how people on insulin keep putting on weight. Compliance is not good enough, and oral medications are more readily accepted. And hence, oral agents were looked at as an alternative to insulin. We started off with clopropamide and tolbutamide, which were tried first, but they are not recommended. They very quickly were kind of dismissed because of their teratogenicity, neonatal hypoglycemia, and other problems. Then came our glibenclamide, which is, of course, known as gliburide, and that is why that is the name of the drug mentioned in all the trials that come from abroad. This was introduced after a landmark trial in 2000 by Langer and Associates. And when that, I still remember when that particular trial reports, the results were published in 2000, there's so much excitement in the department. Everybody looking at it and saying, oh, so how nice. And you can easily more easily manage our gestational diabetics. Subsequently, metformin was introduced after its safety in the first trimester proven in women with polycystic ovarian syndrome. And that is how it got extrapolated to rest of the pregnancy. So we look at glibenclamide in gestational diabetes first, because that's a drug that came in first. Now, neonatal outcomes with glibenclamide versus insulin, there have been several prospective retrospective cohort studies which did not show any difference in large for gestational age infants, macrosomia, neonatal ICU admissions, fetal anomalies, perinatal mortality, or any of the other outcomes. But there is one randomized trial which was published in 2005, which reported in the glibenclamide group an increase in macrosomia and neonatal hypoglycemia. So the cohort study did not show any difference in the outcome, but the RCT in 2005 was the first one to actually draw our attention to this increase in the macrosomia and neonatal hypoglycemia. Till then, from the time Langer study was published, everybody was using this pretty happily, or at least we were. Then came the meta-analysis in 2015. Of course, there were others, but one of the important ones, a systematic review and meta-analysis published in 2015 in BMJ, which included 15 trials and 2,500 subjects, clearly showed that, as you can see, the birth weight definitely favored insulin as opposed to glibenclamide, and so did the occurrence of neonatal hypoglycemia. And these were, again, they were statistically significant, as I have shown here. Therefore, glibenclamide versus insulin, there was an increase in mean birth weight, macrosomia, and neonatal hypoglycemia. There were no difference in secondary outcomes. Now, comparison of glibenclamide and insulin subsequent meta-analysis, again published in 2017, actually showed that there was no difference in macrosomia, but there was still a definite increase in neonatal hypoglycemia. And therefore, they definitely expressed that the neonates, the babies, have to be monitored closely for hypoglycemia. Though, of course, none of them reported any mortalities or very adverse outcomes in the neonates. So in women with gestational diabetes, glibenclamide is comparable to insulin. Maternal outcomes are similar. Neonatal hypoglycemia should be watched for. Birth weight may be increased by about 100 to 200 grams. Other perinatal outcomes are similar. Additional insulin may be required in some. And this is what we all know after all the meta-analysis. And therefore, it is a reasonably good drug to use in gestational diabetes. Then, of course, we came metformin. And let's take a look at what the literature says about its use. There were early trials which showed that the safety and efficacy was similar to insulin. Metformin does not cause maternal hypoglycemia or neonatal hyperinsulin. Even in the mother, hypoglycemic attacks are actually quite infrequent with metformin, as we all know. Used in doses up to 2.5 grams, additional insulin may be required in as many as 46% in some trials and 10% in the other. And the GI side effects, which all of us worry about and the patient complains about, actually decrease with time. So when you look at metformin in GDM, there are several studies. I've just listed them to starting with 2007. And as you can see, the important or the noticeable outcomes are that a fetal macrosomia was less in the metformin group, and the less weight gain in the mother and less frequent neonatal hypoglycemia. These were the noteworthy outcomes in the various studies that we have that I have listed. So metformin was associated with less maternal weight gain, no maternal hypoglycemia, less fetal macrosomia, less neonatal hypoglycemia, where other maternal and perinatal outcomes were similar. So this probably what I have highlighted is the difference between glibenclamide and metformin when it comes to gestational diabetes. There are several randomized trials and meta-analysis, but I am just mentioning the MIG trial because it's a landmark study published in 2008 in NEJM. and consisted of a large number of women, 750, with equal numbers in both the metformin and in the insulin group. And this trial showed that there was no difference in primary and secondary outcomes, no adverse effects, and almost 50% required additional insulin. There are three meta-analyses I'm going to highlight. One in 2014, again comparing metformin and insulin, showing that they're more or less similar outcomes, but a decrease in the preeclampsia in the 2014 one. The 2017 meta-analysis showing that there was a definite decrease in the risk of neonatal hypoglycemia, large for gestational infants, and preeclampsia or pregnant induced hypertension. And the latest one in 2020, which again shows more or less the same effects, but the differences were modest with a wide confidence interval. So the conclusion following these, looking at these trials, is that in women with gestational diabetes, metformin alone or with supplemental insulin is not associated with the increase in perinatal complications as compared to insulin alone. Maternal weight gain is less, macrosomia and large for gestational age is less. The women preferred metformin to insulin treatment when it was used alone. Of course, there were some worries about the long-term effects on the neonates or the babies, because metformin crosses the placenta, and therefore the follow-up studies were undertaken, the TOFU study, the offspring follow-up study, to compare the body composition in children of women who participated in the MIG trial that I referred to earlier, and in particular to compare the adiposity. And the outcomes at 2 years actually showed there is similar body fat, but greater subcapsular fat and bicep skin fold thickness, larger upper arm circumference. Basically, these mean that there is less visceral fat and the fat distribution is more favorable and reduces insulin resistance even in the offspring. These children have been followed up to 7 to 9 years in the two groups. The mothers were not followed up and the children were assessed in Adelaide and then in Auckland, and they found that metformin or insulin for GDM was associated with similar offspring total and abdominal body fat. However, metformin exposed children were slightly larger at 9 years, but this was not considered to be of much clinical importance. Then, of course, people wanted to look at, okay, we know all about metformin. Okay, we know all about glibenclamide. But then if we look at these two, which one do we choose? So head-to-head comparisons have been done in several trials, almost 11 studies with 1,500 women they have been looked at. And there's a review, Cochrane review, available in 2017. And they found that if you compare the two, there's no difference in perinatal mortality, macrosomia, or neonatal hyperglycemia. But of course, metformin was associated with lower mean birth weight, less macrosomia, less gestational weight gain, less composite neonatal serous morbidity. Basically, this is because metformin reduces weight gain in the mother and also reduces the incidence of macrosomia. I mean, it could be because of the diarrhea and other things it causes. It could be because of the peripheral insulin resistance. Whatever be the mode of action, that is the effect of metformin. And there is a less frequency of gestational hypertension as well. So the benefits and potential harms of one oral hypoglycemic agent over the other is unclear, maybe marginal, but metformin is what is preferred by most. Now, people then compared metformin versus insulin and metformin versus glibenclamide. And the important outcomes that were looked at was obviously birth weight, because that's one that has been coming up again and again as a major difference or important difference between metformin and glibenclamide. And when we look at birth weight, you can see that it favors, when you compare it with the insulin, metformin, it favors metformin. And when you look at neonatal hyperglycemia, again, it favors metformin. So these are the, obviously these two are emerging as the most important outcomes. So the conclusion from this meta-analysis, looking at the these comparisons is that glibenclamide is associated with higher birth weight, macrosomia, neonatal hypoglycemia. In GDM, glibenclamide is inferior to metformin and insulin, and metformin is slightly better than insulin alone. There is a randomized controlled trial that was performed in CMC and was published in Australian News, New Zealand Journal 2015. That is comparison of neonatal outcomes in women with GDM, moderate hypoglycemia on metformin and glibenclamide, a randomized trials. And we found that composite neonatal outcome was better in the metformin group, neonatal hypoglycemia significantly more in glibenclamide, and no difference in maternal outcome. So what's the message ultimately from this trial was that metformin is safe for the mother, effective in controlling gestational diabetes, and safe for the fetus, and neonatal hypoglycemia is less. So now we again come back to the question, is it insulin or is it oral hypoglycemic agents? Then if it is oral hypoglycemic agent, is it metformin or is it glibenclamide? Now, in gestational diabetes, after medical nutrition therapy, insulin is the standard of care. There is no questioning it. Oral hypoglycemic agent is a reasonable alternative given the patient compliance and patient preferences. Many of these studies have looked at the patient preference, and most of them have obviously and reasonably voted for oral hypoglycemic agents. Metformin is a reasonable and safe first-line alternative to insulin, especially in countries like India, where in the community, prevalence or incidence of gestational diabetes in the community is quite high because of the high carbohydrate diet for various practical reasons. And trying to manage them with insulin, trying to educate them, have them monitored very closely is extremely difficult. And therefore, it is definitely a reasonable, or metformin is definitely a reasonable alternative and for as first-line therapy. One is not clearly superior to other. However, metformin has some advantages and is the preferred drug. And the oral hypoglycemic agents can be used together when one fails, meaning you can actually add glibenclamide to metformin. And if an OHAs and insulin can be used together as well. American College, ACOG, and American Diabetic Association recommend insulin as a first-line treatment after medical nutrition therapy and exercises. But they endorse the use of OHAs as well and said that under given some circumstances, you can certainly use metformin. The Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine accepts OHA as a reasonable and safe first-line therapy. NICE and FIGO recommend OHA as acceptable first-line treatment. Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines in India considers metformin as acceptable first-line treatment after 20 weeks of gestation. Most guidelines recommend insulin if the fasting blood glucose is more than 110 milligrams. Thank you very much for your patient attention. Thanks.